figure out a way with, you know, especially with time travel and, you know, time wormholes and sort of multiverse time travel storytelling. There's ways of bringing some of those characters back in.
Hi again. Hi. So thank you so much for your time. It's a pleasure to talk to you. And, you know, just congratulate on the movie, like 2.5 million households and counting. And it's amazing. It's amazing. Did you thought about that when, like, you're making the movie that is going to hit a lot of, like, the whole world, especially Brazil, Japan, everywhere?
Yeah, it's pretty amazing. I heard somebody say, I don't know how anecdotal this fact is, but I heard that over 1 billion people watched the movie. So that's pretty amazing for the movie to have that global of a reach around the world and to get as much feedback as I've gotten literally from every corner of the planet for people that have watched it and liked the movie. It's a filmmaker's dream come true to be able to connect to people like that.
Exactly. You made one of the movies that we love a lot at home, Lego, the Lego Batman movie.
Oh, yeah.
That's our favorite movie here at home. So how was, like, this transition to Lego with animation and go to this live action, all over the place movie, all over the place in a good sense? Like, you have a lot of action scenes, a good cast and all this. I don't know. How was the transition to that?
Yeah, I mean, look, in animation, you can control everything down to the finest detail, and in live action, you can control nothing. So it's a big difference. But you know, there's a lot of processes that are very similar. You build an animatic in animation. You build an animatic in pre-viz in live action in order to make sure your action scenes are tight and doable for the budget and all that kind of thing, and also so the visual effects department knows what to do with the creatures and all that kind of thing. So there's a lot of similarities, especially for a movie like this, that the similarity to animation. But it's just playful being able to be, you know, in a voiceover booth. I'm working with an actor. I'm creating a world. I'm telling, you know, Will Arnett or Zach or Chris Pratt or whoever, when we're in a voiceover booth, this is where this other character is. There's an explosion over here. You know, this thing's crazy. The Lego bricks are falling down on top of you, whatever it is. This is the reality. This is what we're doing. On live action, you're just doing that out on the street and there's a camera running around following you, but you're still doing the same thing. There's white spikes over there. The burning Miami's behind you. There's, you know, all of that kind of thing. The Humvees are coming from this direction, that sort of thing. So you are, again, engaging as a director, you're engaging the actors on a real, like, childlike creative level. And that's, you know, that's fun.
Yeah, there also was, like, in the news that we're going to have a sequel and very exciting about it. There is anything that you, I don't know if you're going to be attached. The news said that you're going to be attached to the movie, to the next movie. But I don't know if you really is. What was, like, there's something that you didn't have in this first one that you'd like to have for the second one?
Well, let's see what I would like to do for the second one. I definitely want to have more Betty Gilpin. I don't have Betty Gilpin in it. I want to have more Sam Richardson. I'd want to have Yvonne and Edwin. I want to have a lot of, you know, the cast back, JK. So I think that would probably start there, that I want to, you know, figure out a way with, you know, especially with time travel and, you know, time wormholes and sort of multiverse time travel storytelling. There's ways of bringing some of those characters back in. So I want to, that would be one thing that I would want to have. So, more Betty Gilpin for sure.
Yeah, it's a great cast. So we can go wrong with that. I always ask this question for the most experienced directors, producers, and do you have an advice to give to young kids that want to pursue a career in this business? Doesn't need to be just entertainment. It can be any business.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, look, you know, I think along the way you learn, I think for me, being a good team member is a big part of any job. Learning that you know, learning how to be empathetic and kind to other people in the place you work, I think is a really good skill. Having empathy for other human beings is a really good skill. It's a good life skill. It's a good skill at work. Trying to understand where someone else is coming from, I think is a really, really good thing. And I think you get further in life the more you can, for lack of a better way of putting it, walk a mile in someone else's shoes. And so for me, that's something that I would say to somebody who wants to, if you want to be a good filmmaker, you gotta understand what the grip department's going through, you gotta understand what the editorial department's going through, you gotta understand what your actors are going through. You have to understand little bits of things about all sorts of people. You understand what the studio, from the studio to the PA, you gotta understand what everybody's going through, and you gotta be able to talk to all those people and help them do a great job and help them be great team members and that kind of thing. Help them be great collaborators. To me, that's a big part of success as in whatever you're going to do. I think to me that's a huge part of it.
That's amazing, Chris. I just want to thank you so much for your time. It's a pleasure to talk to you. I cannot wait for the sequel of this movie and also for the Lego Batman movie too next year. Thank you so much.
Thank you. It's nice talking to you. Take care.
Bye bye.
Bye bye.
If you like this video, don't forget to comment, to like, and subscribe to our channel right here.